taken or not. Since I don't know, I better do that. So, good to see everyone. Hello?
Hello.
Hello there in the back. Well, the theme today is grow in the kingdom, or grow in God's kingdom, or something like that. And I tell you, I have printed out the scripture, and I just kind of have a sense about things, and so I'm here mostly as someone who has been blessed by God and has been blessed by you. I grew up in a time when kingdom and all that was a big conversation, and in the church it was a really, really big deal to look forward to the kingdom and the building of the kingdom and the return of Christ and how that may or may not fit into that. And so it's been a guiding longing and hope for me throughout my life. And it remains today. And as I look out at the world, and I go like, holy smokes, how's this all going to come together? How's it even going to come together in our country, let alone the rest of those, you know, those other people? The ones that we somehow need to find a way to love as our, literally, our brothers, our sisters, our sons, and our daughters. But yet, this is the call. This was the call that Christ gave over and over throughout his 3.5 years of ministry. The kingdom is among us. The kingdom is here already. The kingdom is something we're looking forward to. Build the kingdom. And here we sit as descendants of those believers and of those who passed along that message. And we still have within us this call to the kingdom. And so I stand here today to bear witness in my testimony that I still believe that not only is it possible, I believe that it will be. And I look forward to that time when the lion shall lie down with the lamb. And I look forward to that time when there will be no more war. And I look inward now, and I look for that kingdom. Not only the seeds planted for that kingdom, but I look for that kingdom in my life and in your lives, in the lives of men, women, and children all over the globe. All of whom were created by the same God, with the same seed planted for that peaceable kingdom. There are some who recognize it more. There are some who have that planted in them. In this faith tradition especially, we have grown from this understanding of this, different than almost anyone else on earth. We are ambassadors of that future time, but also bearers of the good news that makes the kingdom now and within us and within our families and communities. So I stand here to say that I believe. Now, if we take the text today from the 4th chapter of Mark, it just kind of takes a small part of it, but I'll at least reference more of the chapter. This is the one that starts out where Jesus is telling parables, and the first one is about the farmer that sows the seeds, and, you know, some of them land in the bogus spots, and the ones with, you know, the gravel and all, you know, the different places, and they represent different things, and then some of them fall on fertile soil, and there is a harvest because of the seed that was planted and was nurtured and was able to grow. And a lot of this has to do, this whole chapter has to do with parables about what the kingdom is like. And then Jesus says, if you can't understand the meaning of this parable, how will you understand all the other parables? The farmer plants the seed by taking God's word to others. Still a little confusing to me, so you can all explain it to me later, but one who makes it grow. It was the earlier parable that talks about all the different ways it's, the seed may land, whether it's going to grow or not. But there is strength in the seed. There is strength because, he says, again, this is what the kingdom is like. That the kingdom has a power. In this case, it says the seed grows. The earth kind of does it. And we're just the, maybe we're the ones who cast the seed out there. This farmer's sitting there knowing, even nowadays, do they really know why that little thing turns into something? I mean, they can break it apart and say, well, this happens and this happens, photosynthesis and all the different things and the nutrients in the soil, but do they really know what makes it alive? What makes it turn into something that could be dead for years? And all of a sudden, put it on the ground, rains here and there, voila, you got a crop. And they're like, dude, this is amazing. So that's kind of how the kingdom is. It's got a power that's bigger than us. It's something that we can't really do on our own. But, you know, I guess there is a part that is played here. Now, before there were farmers, things grew. But to grow a crop, you need a farmer. You need somebody to at least plant the seed. In our case, that in what we are talking about now, as far as the seeds of the kingdom, that's part of our part, is to take that life of the seed that the kingdom that was placed within us and to begin to sow it in ways that we can help, but so that the kingdom life that has always been and always will be will have its room to expand into new fertile soil and to make the crop abundant. Now for us, that could result from invitation. It could be from invitation to church or not. It could be an invitation to camp. It could be an invitation to journey group or to dinner or to anything that helps you invite and connect someone into this understanding, into these blessings that have been bestowed upon us and been bestowed upon people of faith throughout time. This result, this spreading of the seed, could come from discernment. Now, some of us in the leadership have just been through the first phase of a discernment process. But this is something that everyone and everything that has ever been created from the dawn of time has this life energy connection within it. Just as there's the life in the seed, there's this kingdom life, you might say, that was from the beginning, that we were meant to, there was meant to be harmony. And I know a lot of times when I try to, one of the ways I try to explain what God is like for me is that God is harmony. It's the harmony of all things. It's the harmony of you and me. It's the harmony of all creation. And harmony of how the universe and everything works together perfectly through this life force. For us to have the ability to even recognize this is amazing to me. And to be a part of it and to actually be able to feel it and respond in ways that may make a difference in that, to be somebody who throws a seed out there. And that seed may grow into something. From doing some of these things, maybe someone you know, or maybe walking down the street, your heart connects with another one's soul. And you feel that there's a need. sometimes you don't understand. You see somebody, you can tell by their countenance. Maybe it's someone you know, maybe it's not. Clarissa has just shared with someone. She told me yesterday about someone she ran into somewhere. And she just could tell that something was not right. And most people would have looked at, I think it was a checker at a check stand. And most people would say, well, that lady's really not friendly, and she's just really, you know, a downer. And so Clarissa recognized something. She said something. And Clarissa's first thought was just the same thing. As, wow, the guy, the next check stand over is really bubbly, and everything's positive, and everybody's having a good time over there. And so she said something to the lady, you know, I don't know what it was, something about recognizing some, you know, how it's her day, or even deeper, knowing Clarissa, it was something more pointed than that. And the lady said, well, I'm going through a divorce that I don't want. And so they had a conversation, and both of them had tears in their eyes as they shared. That happens to us, doesn't it? You know that it does. Sometimes we say something, sometimes we don't. But through discernment, your heart connects with another soul. Sometimes it's bringing home the lost and helping them find a home. We talk about our church and our congregation being a spiritual home, where anyone who comes in feels like, this is my family. I like this place. I want to live with these people. This is my home. We may, through discernment, find ourselves responding and binding up the wounds of the hurt and the broken. We may shine the light of forgiveness into a life of shame and guilt. Can you think of things that may have happened, or other ways where, through discernment, and that discernment again comes from this life force that was put in all things. Some people have the ability to discern the natural world and the needs of that. Some people more so in the in the emotional needs. Some people in the physical needs of people, or of just the resources of the earth. But that connection was built into all of us way before, and whether or not we recognize it. But the kingdom needs farmers. Just as a farmer cannot make a crop without the life and the seed, humans can't make the kingdom without the light and energy of God that flows through and resides literally in all things. I actually wrote that down. How can I describe the kingdom of God, says Jesus? What story should I use to illustrate it? It is like a mustard seed planted in the ground. It is the smallest of all seeds, but it becomes the largest of all garden plants. It grows long branches, and birds can make nests in its shade. Especially when I was younger, I can't say it's went away, but I've had different things in my mind that I felt a calling or some way that I could change the world. And a lot of us, me included, had some big things that I thought I would do in my life. things through discernment and through chance and through someone else calling me that had a need that I didn't even want to go see him or talk to him or lay my hands through the power of God on them. Things happen. And as we all know, just like the butterfly effect, you know, perhaps you think that you haven't done anything, but maybe someone that you don't even remember the conversation, a kid in your neighborhood, or someone who was struggling at a check stand or something, something clicked in them because of your encounter with them. And their life was changed. And they begin to dwell in the scriptures. They learn about prayer. They go back to a childhood of faith. And then they share stories and read to their grandchildren or to their children who otherwise wouldn't have been faithful, maybe have clicked somehow, and they become a person of faith. And somewhere along the line, in the downline of that, things happen in this world that are huge, huge. Nobody can say it like Trump. So, anyway, we don't always need to, we never need to feel like we are not huge. And that our life has been too small. And it is never too late to recognize that love and that energy that has been placed within us and respond to it. I'm going to read a song. It's called Dream Small. I don't think I've ever heard that term. It's always dream big, you know? And some people I know that listen to the Christian radio know the song. It's by Josh Wilson, and it goes like this. It's a mama singing songs about the Lord. It's a daddy spending family time when the world says he can't afford it. These simple moments change the world. It's a pastor in a tiny little church, 40 years of loving for the broken and the hurt. These simple moments change the world. Dream small. Don't bother like you've got to do it all. Just let Jesus use you where you are. One day at a time, live well. Loving God and others as yourself. Find little ways where only you can help. With His great love, a tiny rock can make a giant fall. Dream small. It's visiting the widow down the street. Or dancing on Friday with your friend with special needs. These simple moments change the world. Of course, there's nothing wrong with bigger dreams. Just don't miss the minutes on your way to your bigger things. Because these simple moments change the world. But dream small. Don't bother like you've got to do it all. Just let Jesus use